Seyon, hi, good afternoon. How are you?
Hi, Ilyas. I'm good. Yeah, how are you?
I'm fine. I'm holding up. It's great to have this this time with you. Seyon, just before we get started, for those relatively small number of people who don't already know you from your previous videos and explanations about tket, can you give us a sense of where you fit into the team? Where are you based physically? How many people in the team and who else is there and what are they doing?
Sure. So I work at the Cambridge CQC office. I've been there since late 2017, when I joined the tket team, or started it, I guess. The tket team is now six or so people. We work mainly on developing tket. It's a continued development process, as well as doing research into new things we can implement in it, and running experiments and things like that.
Today, 5 or 6 years after the firm was started, I'm beginning to recognize some of the key principles that we wanted to adopt. One of those principles was that tket would make users more capable of getting the best out of quantum computers, especially early stage computers. And the reciprocal of that, of course, is that people who are building these machines would be able to offer them so that they were easier to use, and whatever concatenation of qubit generation and measurement and manipulation there might be, something like tket could make it more effective. And then obviously the main goal is to have applications that sit on that. For somebody who, let's say, wasn't aware of the deep background that's gone into this, and you were meeting them for the first time, let's say a non-specialist, somebody who's not a scientist, and you were to try and describe tket today, where would you start? How would you give them a tour of what tket does and why it is that you're so excited about it?
Yeah, so I guess I'd start with what its overarching goal is, which is to make writing algorithms or software that runs on quantum computers as easy as possible, but then on top of that, make them as successful as possible. And in that sense, it's a piece of software that sits between you and the quantum computer and allows you to program the quantum computer and retrieve results from it and things like that. And on top of that, the where it really excels is taking sort of abstract, easy to understand things that you write in your software and then turning them efficiently into the instructions that the machine understands.
So the first thing that I want to just check is whether we are really just talking about a compiler. Isn't this just a compiler? Is that what it is?
A compiler is, I guess, a very defined thing in classical computer science. And today we see it very much in as it relates to the modern state of classical computation, wherein we have these classical computers and CPUs, but we also, the machine itself comes with so many layers of abstraction on top that when we actually go to program it, we write in some really abstract generic languages that allows us to express our programming thoughts in very high level ways. And the compiler in that sense has the role of taking layers of abstraction away one at a time until it produces machine instructions. And in the quantum case, however, like we are very, very far from that stage. The number of layers of abstractions that are possible now are quite small. That job is so narrow that all the other things that it does are also important to consider. And those are, I mean, optimization is also a thing that classical compilers do, but it's not a thing that defines a compiler in such so much so that when you speak about it in the classical sense, you have to define an optimizing compiler. Whereas for tket, it's very integral to how we think of it and how we build it, because optimizing quantum circuits is so much more important than optimizing classical programs.
Let's just assume diagrammatically that the compiler is in the middle of what tket could do. And a compiler, as you've explained, might take some algorithm and convert it into instructions for a gate-based quantum computer. Can you, however, explain what tket also does as we get a perspective that looks down towards the metal? And then separately, what else does tket do apart from compile when you look up towards the user? Can you give us a flavor of the functionality that you guys have built into tket? And what, again, why is that important?
Starting from the bottom, as it were, when we provide instructions to a device, there are some certain problems that are innate to quantum devices, as it were, that are not things that were previously solved for classical computers. One of these is one of the most important ones, especially with superconducting quantum computers, is you have to move the qubits around on the device because they can only talk to their nearest neighbors. And this is a problem we call routing, and tket has one of the, if not the best current performing algorithms implemented in it for doing this generically across differently connected architectures. And that's something that acts towards the bottom, but there's other features that are dependent on the device, such as accounting for different noise levels at different points in the device. And these are things we try and sort of make sure that the user doesn't have to worry about. And so these happen within tket towards the end of its action.
When you say the end, what you closest to the metal.
That's right.
On that part of what tket does, is it essential for you guys to be literally next to the metal? Do you have to be with the machine, or have you been able to design this really outside of the orbit of the actual physical machine? How easy has that been?
Well, fortunately, if we keep talking about parallels between development of classical computation and quantum computation significantly benefits from classical computation already existing. And for answering this particular question, the fact that cloud computing is a thing benefits us hugely, because quantum devices as they are now are highly sensitive, very expensive, quite large physics experiments or labs, I guess, that have to be carefully controlled by the manufacturers or the universities designing them. But fortunately, their control or instructions to be sent to them can be done via the cloud, via the internet. And fortunately, the manufacturers and people building these devices have set up fairly standardized ways of providing instructions to these machines over the web. And some of them also do us the favor of telling us about the status of the machine and reporting that to tket. So tket can use that information when it does what it does. And so by using cloud connections to devices, we don't physically have to be next to the machine. And users can download tket themselves and run it from their laptops.
So turning our attention back towards the user, what does tket do, or what has tket done to make life easier for them, other than obviously the layers of abstraction being advanced?
A user today can, if they want to use tket, they can get it as a Python package. And so we built this interface into the Python programming language to make it as easy as possible for scientists and experimentalists and new quantum programmers to get started. And in that, we've developed a really easy to use interface for writing circuits, a really nice interface for using different backends. So you can write your circuit in Python and then not have to change any of your code to send it off to different devices or different simulators. Yeah, so it's a very intuitive but powerful interface for writing quantum programs and building them up from smaller structures into larger ones.
Whenever I find myself talking to a non-specialist about tket, and I try and give a balanced overview of how this project to develop a compiler originally has broadened and deepened and become so much richer in its functionality, and obviously it's a class-leading product right now, a very large percentage of people who I speak to end up saying, oh, it's an operating system then. And I then have to stop. Will tket be an operating system? Is that where you guys are heading in one respect? And why don't we call it an operating system today?
So as I mentioned earlier, the way tket works is you download it onto your laptop, and if you're using a quantum computer, it remotely talks to that quantum computer for you. Now, if we think of what operating systems are now, the idea of downloading an operating system onto my computer here, which is an operating system for a different computer that's far away, doesn't really make much sense. An operating system is something that very much lives right on top of the hardware and manages everything to do with the hardware and lets other programs talk to the hardware via it. And it's a very live piece of code, right? It's not something that just does some processing for you and then hands off to the machine. It is very much part of the machine's operation. And in that sense, quantum computers are basically not anywhere near mature enough for a fully fledged operating system to live on top of them. We can call the control software that they already run to run the sort of experimentals of it the predecessors of what will eventually become their operating systems. And you could very well argue that some of the core functionality of Tket is also something that will be required in these eventual operating systems, because quantum computers will really be accelerators to classical computation. Will also need to be larger pieces of software that handle the communication between a larger, say, supercomputer, classical supercomputer, and the quantum computing chip and things like that. And so what I'd really say is there are various pieces that exist at the machine end and in things like Tket, but they will, I think, grow into what becomes the operating systems that handle quantum computation in the future.